The National High School Mock Trial Championship takes place this week in Phoenix. We'll hear from officials involved with the event, but first, David Major takes us to the state finals that took place at the end of March.
Commanding the courtroom and making their case. These are some of the finest pretend attorneys Arizona has to offer.
Yes.
Now, Officer Knight, when you made this affidavit, you...
By laying blame and casting doubt, this cast of characters seeks nothing short of victory and a spot in the 2011 National High School Mock Trial Championship taking place in Phoenix. Members of this team from the Arizona School for the Arts have been there before. They won the state championship in 2010. Now they're hoping to repeat, which won't be easy. Mock trial never is.
Imagine that you're really trying to get, you know, that you're trying to convict this person or get him off the hook. Like, really believe that. If you believe that, I think it's going to go a lot better.
Months before stepping into the courtroom, students start prepping in a classroom, getting ready to go to trial.
May it please the court, counsel, Your Honor.
2 hours every Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday of rehearsal, plus memorizing everything and practicing everything. So it's a big time commitment.
They'll have to argue a make-believe case written for the competition by legal professionals. This year, it's about a young woman who pledges a co-ed fraternity and dies after drinking large amounts of water during a game of Water Jeopardy.
Jessica knew that playing Water Jeopardy could be dangerous.
You know, you get the case, which is completely just pages of information, and it's affidavits, it's exhibits, it's evidence, and you have to take all of that and combine it and condense it into an articulate, well-thought-out argument that you have to present in less than 35 minutes. And that's really, really difficult.
She didn't mention being threatened when she attempted to leave.
It's very similar to a real trial. The only difference is there are time limits.
Retired Arizona Supreme Court Justice Michael Ryan has been judging mock trial competitions for more than two decades.
And I often would say through the years, I said, you know, I wish we had this, or I wish I had you guys in front of me, because you can really put on a case much better than some lawyers that I've seen.
Hypothyroidism is just the kind of factor that would make a teenager more likely to die from hyponatremia, isn't that right?
No, I don't believe so.
Let's go back a little bit.
The students have to learn the case inside and out because during competition they rotate roles. Sometimes they're the prosecution, sometimes the defense.
And they don't know until they, you know, right before they start, which side they're going to be.
The students also alternate between the roles of attorney or witness.
The bottom line is you got to know your content. You have to practice and practice and practice. And I think that's one thing that, you know, every team needs to focus on. I think what separates actually the good teams from the great teams, though, comes down to presentation.
That's something you might think would favor a performing arts school.
I do think it helps. Our attorney coach kind of laughs about it because he's like, you know, for a school that's an arts school, he's like, you guys are awful actors. Like, we just, in a courtroom setting, it's just different, like, the way you approach it.
To defuse the great cross, which...
This year, members of ASU's Sun Devil Mock Trial team helped the students with their approach. And in late March, the School for the Arts sent two teams to the state finals at the federal courthouse in Phoenix.
As a defendant, explain to Jessica.
Teams present their cases in front of real attorneys and judges who either preside over the case or sit in the jury box scoring each round.
We base our scoring solely on performance.
Because most cases tend to favor one side or the other, winning the verdict isn't the ultimate goal.
So you could lose the verdict, you know, I mean, the verdict could be against you, but you win because your performance was so well done.
Objection, Your Honor. Lack of foundation.
Your Honor, may I be heard?
Big points are awarded to teams that show they can think on their feet.
Let's say someone is asking a question and there's an objection. And, you know, you ask the basis for the objection, you know, then you ask the student who's asking the question, you know, what's your response? And that, you know, shows you a lot. You know, if they can give you a good, clear response that's correct, that really adds to their score.
I guess objections would be my least favorite part. You have to think on your feet a lot. You can't really plan for who's going to object to what. and what your response is going to be, or who's going to say what and what you have to object to. So,
after each round, scores are tallied and the teams are paired for the next round of competition.
Courtroom 601 should be FTX.
They're assigned a three-letter code so judges don't know which schools they're judging. Late in the day, after completing several trials, the top two teams faced off in the final round. Last year's champ, the Arizona School for the Arts, was one of them. The other, a team from University High in Tucson.
I had read a news article where a woman had died from drinking too much water.
Objection, hearsay, and foundation.
Blow by blow, strike by counterstrike, they showed why they're the best. And they demonstrated what mock trial has to offer.
I think the best thing about the program is they learn about the legal system.
They learn about the law, but they also gain valuable life skills.
Exactly. I think it builds confidence.
Their analytical abilities. I mean, the way these people now, you know, my students dissect their arguments is amazing. And really what I've noticed in the classroom is that translates over into their academic work. And so they improve even as people.
I think I've gotten a good deal of confidence, really. Like when I came in, like, I was very quiet.
Could you please identify this document to the court?
Many of these kids become attorneys. Many say, I don't want to be an attorney. It's too much work. But
my mom's a lawyer, and I don't want to go into law. And everybody asks, you know, do you want to go into law? Your mom's a lawyer, and you're in mock trial. No, I couldn't deal with the clients, you know? So it is fun. Competing is just a joy.
But finding out who wins can be stressful. At the end of the day, only one team would be state champ, and that team was University High. The Arizona School for the Arts took second place in the state finals. But to Justice Ryan, every team's a winner.
And it gives you confidence in the future of this community and the country.
And we should note that although the team from Arizona School for the Arts did not win the state championship, it will be competing in the national competition. And here to talk about the high school mock trial program is U.S. District Court Judge Stephen McNamee, a longtime supporter of mock trial and a judge in local and national competitions. And also joining us is Dewain Fox, a former mock trial student who went on to become an attorney. He has leadership roles in both the state and national high school mock trial programs. My goodness. Thank you for being here. We appreciate
it. Thank you.
Let's start. We got a lot of information there. Talk more, though, about just how you pick teams and how you pick students and who gets involved in all this sort of stuff.
Well, it's really a volunteer effort. And we see them in the competition. Dewain would probably know how the schools get picked. But it's getting schools interested and getting a volunteer teacher and getting a volunteer coach to work with these young people, and they do a fabulous job.
I thought it was fascinating to see that these kids, they have to argue both sides. They have to be witnesses too.
They do, and they have to switch off back and forth. They at the state tournament, they're guaranteed the opportunity to be the plaintiff two times and the defense two times. So most teams have somebody play attorney on one side and witness on the other side. At the national tournament, it doesn't have the same restriction.
Talk about the national tournament. How many teams now are competing this week?
We have a record number of 48 teams. The most that we've ever had at nationals before is 44.
And how do you decide who gets there? Because I noticed that the second place team from Arizona is going to be there. So who gets to be invited?
The second place team from here is going to be there because we have 47 teams and we don't want to have a bye situation. So we have to have an even number of teams. But every state is entitled to send its state champion. And in addition to that, we have four teams competing from outside the U.S. We have Guam, Northern Mariana Islands, South Korea, and we also have, for the first time ever, Australia.
Interesting. Now the cases themselves, these are fictional cases, correct?
They're fictional cases, but they're based on some real-life events that have occurred in some fashion. And they change every year, and so it's always an interesting time for the kids to get involved with the real-life experience.
What makes a good mock trial case?
Well, I think that you try and balance it out between there's no right or wrong answer to the case. It depends on each side has some good points and you have some glitches in your case that you have to overcome, like a bad witness or the witness has some background issues, things like that come out before the jury when you have to argue them.
And as far as the teams are concerned, talk about the caliber now that we'll be seeing at this national event. That's the best of the best, I take it.
Exactly. You will see top-notch kids from all over, well, really the world, and they just are just wonderful things. This is a great opportunity for Arizona. I just can't tell you what an opportunity this is for Arizona.
And Arizona has done well in the past in these competitions. I think you have firsthand experience on that, haven't you?
I do. Fortunately, we won the national championship in 97. And when I was coaching at Deer Valley High School, we also had a couple of runner-up finishes at the national level. And before that, we actually in Arizona were the first state to win the national championship twice. Xavier College Preparatory actually won it the first time in 1987.
We saw in the tape package, we saw some pretty confident-looking kids up there. Really seem like they know what they're talking about. Talk to us about what is learned and the progress that one of these competitors goes through.
Well, when they first start out practicing, I mean, they really don't have a lot of skills. They don't have any knowledge about the legal rules, the rules of evidence in particular. And that's the job of the coaches, the teacher coach and the attorney coach. And frankly, that's one of the things that was always exciting when I was coaching, is to see the development of these kids. So you start out with a student who is the one boy on the tape pointed out that he was quiet, didn't know what to do, and now he is very confident. He's a very good mock trial performer.
Interesting. What do judges look for? The criteria? What do they keep an eye out for?
Well, their performance and their adherence to the rules and their adherence to time limits. Everybody has a time limit in their life, and they've got to do an awful amount of work, a great quantity of work within a given time frame. So you have to make judgmental decisions about what to include, what to exclude, and there's choices you have to make along the way that affects your case.
And public speaking, presentation,
yes.
convincing arguments, these sorts of things, all factored in?
All factored into it, and they do. And we look for persuasion. How persuasive are they in the argument? How much do they adhere to the rules, and are they ethical? Are they honest in their approach to things? That's important.
Talk about the benefits of this program.
Well, I think you get a lot of benefits. As Dewain pointed out, you get public speaking, you get confidence, you get team building, you strength of character, discipline. You learn how to operate as a team, adaptability, time management, ethical considerations, all of which develop into life skills that are applicable throughout your life.
And not all of these kids, as we learned from the tape, not all of these kids go on to become attorneys, do they?
No, they don't. In fact, when I participated, I wasn't planning to become an attorney, but through working with the Deer Valley program, I decided that's what I wanted to do. But as Judge McNamee pointed out, these are life-building skills regardless of what you do in your future life.
I often run into somebody at the grocery store, and they'll say, "You were my judge at mock trial, but here's what I'm doing now." And they just go on and on about the benefits they got from the program. It's a tremendous character-building activity.
It's a great program. Good to have you both on to talk to us about it. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having us.